Good morning. I am Minister Edward J. Robin, coming to you again from Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, on the 9th day of November 2020. I thought I would come to you again, as I have over 300 times on various topics, and express to you again the simple but totally extraordinary and unusual action of a man or a woman having faith in Christ, exercising their faith before men and women acting as public authorities in whichever country that you live in that may have ratified the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. Just going to move my microphone here so you might hear a little bit of a sound. Now, the reason that International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights was put in place is very important, understanding the basis of why that was done, subject to the 1948 International Covenant on Human Rights, which was indicated in part by Eleanor Roosevelt and the risk management people for the insurance underwriters worldwide. And I stress how important it is to understand what was the motivation for a bunch of men and women to get together and say, we need to put a document together establishing freedom, and that how that freedom, or freedoms in the plural, cannot ever be taken away. They are permanent, God gifted and granted. Now, in the case of certain discriminatory actions that are not so-called God gifted and granted, one must examine very closely what the word freedom is as opposed to the word rights. And I say this basically, I want to be very plenary, complete, full, non-confusing, and extremely detailed with the differences between what freedom is and rights. Now, we have all heard the word rights bandied about for a long time. In Canada, we have the Canadian Charter of Rights and freedoms. It's interesting that they put rights first, certainly not alphabetical, freedoms would come first. And it's also interesting that they put something artificial first, rather than something that's real, actual, as being first. Now, men recognizing that freedoms were established in Genesis 1:26 through 1:29 in the King James Bible, and I'm relying on that particular document as the standard of form throughout the world and as part of the basis for this International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. One of the civil and political rights that you get to have, aside from many others, is your right to have a faith and belief that allows you to do anything you want except hurting men or women or their property, and that includes offending them. For if we are truly to be brothers and sisters in the anointed, the Redeemer, the man who come to offer his blood to save us from being subjected to man's criminal code, that man offered us the repeat, the reestablishment, the replenishment of our freedoms that other greedy and lofty men, adopting the greedy and lofty ideals of Satan, trying to overpower God, got the idea that they could overpower men's freedoms by telling them, I am God, the whole world shall worship me and pay me taxes, like all of the Caesars of the Roman Empire. Now, once you understand that freedom God gifted and granted cannot be taken away by men, well, now you're really on to something. Because the whole of the world has been taught that you have rights, and they don't talk a lot about freedoms. The reason that is because a long time ago, when this International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights was being drafted and put together by employees for risk management for companies like Lloyd's of London, they knew that if they were too out front with it in the explanation, that not too many people would sign up for rights. Because when you sign up for rights, it's assumed that you're a person. And those people that wish to be a little bit more complete in their study can go look at the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. You can find it very easily by typing in ICCPR. And read Article 16 of that International Covenant so you can take in and drink the knowledge of what it's providing. It says everybody has the right to be recognized as a person before the law. Well, if you have the right, remember I told you the difference between rights and freedoms. If you have the right to be recognized as a person, then you certainly have the right to ignore Deuteronomy 1:17 in the King James Bible, where God is telling us that he doesn't respect persons. He repeats it in Deuteronomy 10:17. He repeats it in 2 Samuel 14 and 14. Onwards through Matthew 22:16, Acts 10:34, Romans 2:11, and finally, for emphasis, clarity, and the detail necessary to make us understand the extent of this, we see James 2 and 9, where it is written, if you should show respect to persons, you commit sin, and shall be convinced of the law as a transgressor. Now take this all in. We have the King James Bible, classified as the Holy Word of God, by those who put it together, revere it, and form ceremonies about it, saying that God's law is the only law, and that if we respect persons, that word persons, that we are sinners. We have a Christian monarch who swore to defend it with all of her power. She swore to defend the church and the clergy. Very interesting, because she used the word promise. I promise I will do so. When asked, will you defend the laws of God, the church, and the clergy? And she said yes. So based upon that promise, we can stand firm in our faith and beliefs, certainly not to be her subjects. She's a woman. And Christ is king. How can a woman claim to have royal blood when there is only one that has royal blood, and it is Yahushua, the man that the King James Bible refers to as Jesus? His mother named him a Hebrew name, not a Greek name. So when he came to reaffirm and establish to all that he came to free us from man's law, well, then that's confirmed by his blood. He was the last sacrifice, the new covenant, after God had divorced Israel. And he knew that all of those old laws and covenants that he made, some of them were against his people. So it's important to note that Colossians 2, verse 14. It's very notable that he said he washed away those laws that were contrary to us. Not for us. So we have to look, well, what laws or codes or ordinance in the scripture were contrary to us and against us? Well, it would seem that according to the love of God and the forgiveness, 7 times 70, that eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth and putting people to death was not God's idea. As we can see, the very first sinner, murderer, Cain, was not put to death. He had a mark put on his forehead and was banished to the land of Nod. So again, we see that there's a deviation from the Old Testament of punishment and harm for harm to love your enemies, forgive them 7 times 70, as the new edict, direction, commandment of our Creator. Now, back to the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. Every service provider in the world that has ratified, that means they've written it into the law of the country. In Canada, you can see it written into the Emergencies Act as ratified in so standing. Anybody whose rights or freedoms, and I'll emphasize freedoms because a lot of people really like that word rights and they want to cling to it tightly. So anybody whose freedoms have been damaged or harmed, they're feeling intimidated, nuisanced, or obstructed, may apply, and this is very important, to a court of competent jurisdiction. But before we're going to any court, and certainly trying to find out and examining the competency of the court, it's very important to note that you must demand accommodation. Now, a demand is the highest form of a question. It doesn't mean that you're going in there screaming and yelling and I want this. It means that you're going in there calm, meek, and humble, and you're demanding accommodation. But before that's done, it's very, very wise, intelligent, and foolproof to ask them humbly if they, as a body, recognized as a corporate government, are adhering to their duty to be in recognition of that international covenant, and when a demand for accommodation comes before them, they have a duty to go to a hardship to accommodate you. Those people that would like to see proof of that beyond an opinion, please type examination of a duty to accommodate in quotation marks and hit enter. You might also add Canada onto that. And you will see the Library of Parliament and a paper on that very subject confirming that it's real. One of the most little-known facts in Canadian law is actually a fact, and it is real, and it's extremely powerful. When you make a demand for accommodation, you can make it in the form or inclusive of an agreement. Christ said in Matthew 5:25, to get an agreement with an adversary quickly. He said in Matthew 18:15-20, how to do it, and the format there, so beautifully descriptive, puts us in line with what is in every civil court rules throughout the world that is signed on to these international covenants. Those civil court rules have the most powerful piece of paper that exists within man's law. It's called a notice to admit or a request for admissions. So I strongly encourage everybody, when they get a chance, to go type in notice to admit or request for admissions into Google, to go read the parallel that exists there with regards to how to establish the truth with a